Mein Name ist Clemens Matznik und als Recording- und Mixing-Engineer freue ich mich heute ganz besonders darauf, Mick Gosowski hier in den Berliner Kung-Fu-Studios treffen zu können. Mick hat unter anderem das Daft Punk-Album Random Access Memories gemischt, mit der Hitsingle Get Lucky mit Pharrell Williams und Nile Rodgers drauf, kennt ihr bestimmt, und dafür auch ein paar Grammy Awards abgesahnt. Sein Sound ist immer ziemlich klar, ziemlich offen, schönes Top-End, sehr definiert, sehr punchy, gute Transienten so. Und er macht das auch schon eine ganze Weile. Seit Mitte der 70er ist Mick schon dabei, hat in den 90ern einige Pop-Diven gemischt, allen voran Mariah Carey. Und jetzt hat er eine Session von Jamiroquai dabei und ich bin gespannt, was er dazu erzählen kann. Vielleicht kommt die ein oder andere Daft Punk-Story noch dabei rum. Viel Spaß. Today I have the pleasure to be here with multi-platinum mixer Mick Gosowski. He won 15 Grammys and he's known for his work in pop and rock and R&B and even hip-hop and jazz and Latin music. So you mix quite a bunch of music.
Yeah, it keeps it from getting boring.
You know, yeah, absolutely. And you've been doing this since when? Since the late 70s?
Actually,
even longer, right?
Even longer, because I mean, I started not professionally, but I started when I was in high school.
So, right.
And then, you know, professionally since about 1975, I'd say.
Okay. And today you brought with you a track that you mixed at your studio.
Yeah.
It's a track by Jamiroquai.
Yeah, from their last album.
Yeah, from the last album. Have you met the band before?
Not in person, because I did this all at home in Los Angeles. They're in England. They contacted me, I think, because they heard the Daft Punk album that I did, and I think that was the reason they contacted me and tried out a song for them, or they wanted to try me on a song, which was this song, and I ended up mixing the album and becoming friends, even though we've never met in person. But
awesome, yeah. Did you listen to their music before?
Yeah, sure. Oh yeah, yeah, of course. I knew who the band was. I was actually very flattered when they called me.
All right, and today you brought with you the first single from that album.
Yeah, Cloud Nine. Cloud Might have been the second single, but I'm not sure.
Oh, okay, one of the singles.
Definitely. Yeah, one of the singles.
Cool. Yeah, shall we have a listen?
Sure.
Awesome. Like all your mixes, this mix also has the punch and the transients, and then it has that nice top end, and definitely gonna dive in more on how you do this.
Sure.
Yeah. How do you lay out the tracks in your session?
Okay, so I usually set it up with the bass at the very top of the session, and then the drum tracks, then percussion tracks, then these are keyboard pad tracks, that I usually have keys next. Sometimes it's the main keys, sometimes it's the pads. Mm-hmm. But I go into the keys section. Here's other keys and synths. Then guitars. There's two separate groups of guitars in this session. I group the tracks of in order how they work together too. Like these several guitar tracks really make up one part, one
right. purpose. Right. So you have song. One subgroup for yeah. that guitar.
Yeah. And then we have background vocals, Jay's background vocals and lead vocal.
Right.
So and then I have my my subgroups that I'll get into in a minute. And I usually, the reason I keep the lead vocal last in the session is towards the end of the mix, I'm usually working on the subgroups a lot more than the individual tracks. Mm-hmm. So the lead vocal is close to the subgroups because that's the one track I'll be working on.
So you're not scrolling up and down.
Yeah, so
all
I don't
the
have to, I don't have to scroll all the way up through how many tracks, this 99 tracks.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Get to the top of the session.
And then your final mix is right way down at the bottom of the session, right?
Yeah, way down at the bottom. There's on some sessions there's returns below this. If I have if effects sends and then returns down this one.
Okay.
The effects sends, there's not much reverb, and the ones that are just on one track, so they're just on. I just inserted them on the track. If I'm using an effect that affects several tracks with the same effect, then I'll use a send and return.
Right. So you're busing all these tracks to different subgroups, as you just mentioned.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. I want to start with how I have it set up on the console.
Yeah.
So see, under bass and drums, I have bass and drum VCA for all these, and that VCA goes to the left of the center section of my S6. I have those subgroups that you saw down there on the right, so I have them right in front of me. Then the VCAs on the left, and I attention the VCAs, they spill their member tracks
out to the right.
So I can be in the center and still control a whole mix that has like 100 tracks like
right.
this one does.
So your Avid S6 has 16 faders on this side, 16
yeah,
on the other one?
16 so on 16.
Yeah.
So on the average, I have 8 VCAs or less, usually 11 or 12 submasters, which are just aux inputs. Then master fader, master VCA. Mm-hmm. So I have the whole session really on about 24 faders. The VCAs, I usually don't do the rides on, so I usually just keep them at unity. But I can adjust them to for how hard I hit the subgroups.
Yeah.
So, but usually the VCAs are mainly there, so just so I can spill the tracks.
Right. So if you want to work on guitars, you just touch the guitar's VCA, and then it spills out all the guitars to your right, and you can do the individual tweaking.
Yeah. So see, here is the drum and bass VCA, so that would spill all these tracks out to the right. Then we have the percussion, then there's a VCA for percussions. Mm-hmm. I put the VCAs in parentheses, or in little stars around them, so I know that they're VCAs. You know, I just have a little method that I could just glance at something and see what it's doing,
right.
what it does. So the VCAs are all set up like that. Then we have these keyboards, pads, and effects. That's another VCA. Moog and strings is another VCA. This group of guitars is a VCA, guitars one. Note how these don't really overlap each other. These pretty much make up the same part, these four mm-hmm. are similar parts. But so all those are on one group. I still have good control because they're not overlapping. These are just doubles.
Right.
And then these guitars really make up one part, so they're on another guitar group. And I balance them within the section, you know, spilling them from the VCAs, then I have them on just one group.
Yeah.
Backgrounds. I have a group for Hazel. She's the background singer and who did all these tracks, so there's a VCA group for her. There's a VCA group for, let's see, that's an audio group. Let's put the VCA. Yeah, Jay background sub, all his backgrounds are. Yeah,
and
there
the
is.
Lead vocal as well.
Yeah. Yeah, the lead vocal, I think he's on this VCA. Sometimes I don't have the lead vocal on the VCA. Sometimes I have it separate. I usually try to keep the actual lead vocal track within these 16 faders that I have the subgroups. Mm-hmm. So this particular mix has, I think it's 11 subgroups, 12. And then after that on the S6, I would have this VCA, which controls all the subgroups, then the master fader,
mm-hmm.
and which I don't use Pro Tools master for. I use an aux because I want to keep any dynamics processing pre-fader.
Pre-fader, yeah.
And then the mix. And then I'll usually have a lead vocal track right over here so I can control the lead vocal. That. And it's especially important if there's a lot of effects on the lead vocal, because if you're controlling it from the group master, then the effects move with the return, and sometimes you want to hit an effect with the vocal.
Exactly.
So if you have the vocal fader there, you can it affects the send of the tracks.
Yeah.
In most cases, you can ride either one of them, but in there's some cases where I'd rather have control over the send.
Yeah. So it's a pretty easy setup.
Where
you just assign all the tracks to your subgroups and then do tweaks inside that subgroup, and then, but in the end,
in the end,
you just work with the subgroup.
Yeah, pretty much. I have to go up into tracks once in a while, but as the mix takes shape, it's like mixing
from the old days,
yeah,
right?
Mixing in the old days, and
so in the end, you end up with like 12 to 16
groups,
and that's where you sit there, and then you have the musical elements of your mix, and you can always tweak them.
And my VCA groups aren't the same as the audio groups. Like you can see here, bass and drums are two separate audio groups, but they're on the same VCA group.
Yeah.
Because they work together, and also I don't want to just have a whole bunch of VCAs and only have five tracks on each or something. So I try to logically lay it out that the instruments that I want to be able to control together are on a VCA group, and then the split I want is on the audio subgroups.
On the audio subgroups. Shall we just have a listen to the drums and the bass maybe with the VCA and see what's going on?
So on this track, the bass is a synth bass. Most of Jamiroquai is a live bass. The bass player is incredible. This particular song is this. I think it's a Jupiter 8.
What did you put on this one? That's,
this one is just
SSL
a little,
channel?
Yeah, just a little compression. I think actually this setting came from them.
Okay.
And I just kept it because it sounded good.
So you listen to what they give you and then decide on what kind of plugins you want to keep.
Yeah.
So if they send you,
especially if it's a mix that they like the overall vibe of the rough and they just want me to improve it.
Right.
I definitely use as much as I can of what they sent me.
Right.
Sometimes I'll change the settings on the plugins they give me slightly to make it work in my mix. And sometimes I'll just use another, if it's EQ, I might put another EQ after it so I know what they gave me and I know what I've done to it.
Right. Do you listen a lot to the rough mix from your clients?
Oh, at first, yeah. At first I try to not entirely duplicate it. I get an idea what
sort
it
of
is.
Be in the ballpark.
And then be in the ballpark of that mix. But things I know I want to change a little bit, I do.
Yeah.
But I try to keep it that the feel is pretty consistent with the rough.
Right.
If that's what the artist wants, and also if the rough is good. Sometimes it's just an idea what parts are there, and then I have to sort of go from the beginning. In a lot of situations, I don't get tracks with processing on them. People send me tracks that have been exported from Logic or another program. Then I just make my own Pro Tools session and go from scratch.
Yeah.
And sometimes they'll send me a rough. Along with that, and of course I use that as a reference. Sometimes there's no rough, so I just very quickly put up some kind of balance and bounce it, so I have some kind of reference as I put things together.
Mm. And do they give you instructions on or wishes, or is it like a lot of communication with the artist that you check up front?
Usually a little bit up front, whether where they feel their rough is, where they feel the example is, or if they want something from me that doesn't relate to their rough. We have a little communications up front. Most communications is after I get the mix together and send them the first pass.
Mm-hmm.
And I think most communication happens there because usually the bulk of any changes happens after the first pass. Then after that, it's just little touch-ups.
Yeah, true.
So they sent me a processed bass that looks like they said it was done through. This Altec processing, one of those old green compressors.
Yeah.
But in combination, it sounds
very good.
Now, we didn't use too much of this. This is the live kit. And since this is the first mix I did for him, I have all the live tracks up, but there's actually not using very much. It's mainly for the hi-hat and cymbals. So you can see here, bass drum out.
You didn't use that,
Yeah, Mike. We didn't use that at all. Mm-hmm. Bass drum isn't very, this particular bass drum isn't very loud in the mix because there's a sequence drum. So it's pretty much...
But the sequence drum came with it, so you didn't trigger any drums on this one. Yeah,
right. Okay. It came with it. If it's a live drum kit that I just can't get to work in the mix, I'll trigger drums with it.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
I usually use a Massey DRT, drum replacement trigger. Generates a MIDI track from the drum, and then I use Superior Drummer, find a sound in there.
Okay.
But anyway, so this was just pretty much the kit is just... pretty just kick snare and hat, couple cymbals, but the main, here's the bass drum sample. Now here's one case where I wanted to change the sound a little. They had lo-fi on it, which I just bypassed because I didn't particularly like it on the kick, and they didn't say anything that I bypassed it, and I wanted to have a little more punch. So here's the Oxford Transmod, this plug-in.
Or more attack.
Yeah, it's like a transient designer. It's you can raise or lower the transient with this plugin. So that's what's on the kick, snare, nothing. It's just how it came to me. Two snares, reverse snare.
But you could put some compression on it, right?
Oh yeah, that's parallel compression.
Parallel compression.
Yeah. Oh, snare. Also this I put. Never mind. It's I did put some parallel compression on the snare. So here's the two snares without the reverse one, and they're going right to the sequence drum bus, but also pre-fader to this 1176 in this EQ.
And what's add the... that
to, see?
Oh yeah.
And the 1176 is set with a fairly slow attack and fast release, so it's letting the transient through, sort of acting as a transient designer almost, but a little different because when it's releasing, it's bringing up the snares and you get...
Right.
Yeah.
You want to mute that one again? Oh, okay. Yeah, well, that does a lot.
Other than making it louder, it's bringing up the decay of it and the attack of it.
Yeah.
You do that by setting the time constants of the compressor. And then after this is just a little bit of EQ, just taking off. We didn't want the real high end of it that was being brought up by the compressor. And then... you'll make it a little fatter with that.
You're using the Fab Filter Pro-Q quite a bit in your sessions.
Pro-Q 2, Pro-Q 3. I love those equalizers. To me, the Fab Filter stuff is the best user interface of anything because it's the user interface is, I think, very intelligently designed for use with a computer.
I think so,
mouse and keyboard. And not trying to look like an old piece of gear, you know, where you're trying to turn the knobs with a mouse. But it's really to me how an EQ equalizer should be set up. You know,
what about the sound of the EQ?
The Fab Filter is very good. It's if I have to say anything, and it's not a negative, is it's sort of clinical. It doesn't have a it does exactly what it's supposed to do.
Doesn't add too much
It has pretty much no coloration.
Yeah,
and especially if you put it on linear phase, it's linear phase mode. It does exactly what it should do. So I use it in conjunction with other equalizers sometimes if I want a character. Like sometimes I like the Universal Audio Manly Massive Passive.
Mm-hmm.
Their version of that's really nice on the bus. You know, they make quite a few good plugins. Also, let's see, what else I'll use? Some of the Air EQs.
We'll probably get into other EQs.
We'll get into the bus a little later,
definitely.
I guess.
What else is there on the sequenced drums? You have the hash loop.
Yeah, there's a reverse snare, which plays every.
All right.
And then the hash loop. And claps. These are in the choruses. So remember, there's also the hat is on the live track too.
Yeah. What did you put on the hat loop? The old Pro Tools 76?
That is, yeah, but that's...
From them, probably?
There's a side chain on that. Just to bring the hi-hat down when the kick hits.
When the kick hits.
Yeah, that was in there. So that was part of their arrangement and stuff.
What about the claps? You added some room to them?
Yeah, Valhalla room. The SSL channel was most likely on there when I got it. Which is, what are we doing? Just a little bit of EQ. Just a short room.
Mm-hmm. And then there's all the percussion going on.
Yeah, because it's... Yeah, so the bass and the live drums and the sequence drums are all on one VCA. Well, you don't think it... But this percussion isn't, because it wouldn't fit. So on this percussion, I have all these cowbells, which I just put on one audio group. And the SSL channel's their EQ. I wanted to get it a little rougher because it's a little hard to hear. So yeah. The one for you, can't change it, baby. I'm not the one for you. I know it, baby. I'm not the one for you. Can't change it, baby. I'm not. These rides were in on their track too. That was part of the original rough. But the decapitator just.
Just some more dirt.
Yeah, just a little dirt on it.
Yeah.
That cowbell sub goes back to the percussion group.
Mm-hmm.
And let's see. So, stuff is pretty self-explanatory. Kabasas, go-go bells, shakers, all that stuff on the percussion group.
Yeah. Maybe we can go to the subgroups for the drums and bass and okay. The percussions and see what you did to the subgroups.
Okay, yeah. So everything we looked at so far is going to these first four subgroups. These first three, bass, drums, sequence drums, as you remember, are on one VCA, but I wanted some split on them for control on the subgroups. So
yeah.
So we have a separate bass audio subgroup, separate drums, separate sequence drums. And as far as processing on those, the bass is a little bit of this wave center,
mm-hmm.
which just keeps low end in the center.
Okay,
you know, because there's that stereo Jupiter bass, remember on there.
Mm-hmm. So, and you didn't want it to, right, to be that left and right.
Yeah, I mean, we don't want the low end of it to be left and right. I always like to center, you know, below about 80 hertz.
Okay.
You know, just for punch, and especially in a song like this, so both woofers are moving in phase the same amount,
right,
on the low end, and, you know, just to give you a little more low frequency energy in the room.
Is that something you do very often on the mixes?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. More often now that I have that BrainWorks 3 from UAD, the BrainWorks 3 equalizer that has the mono control, you call it mono maker. Which is just a filter that combines the channels below the frequency that you set on it.
Do you have like a rough frequency, or do you adjust it according to the song?
I adjust it according to the song. Usually ends up between 60 and 100.
Okay. Just to give the bass frequencies a more centered perspective in the track, and have the woofers move at the same time.
Yeah, and it works nicely. Even if you have a track with a lot of low frequency component in it and a lot of stereo, the bass down that low isn't that directional.
So right,
you have more energy from both woofers, but you still have the stereo perspective of the higher end of the track. Okay, bass, little compression on it. Very little. Now in the rain. Drums. Doing a little parallel compression with this, with the H compressor. Just one thing seemed to make you care. And there's a little bit of limiter on this. This is something I do quite often is on drum tracks and percussion tracks. I put a limiter on the subgroup. And the limiter isn't really doing much, but in cases where two drums attack at the same time, and you might have a peak 6-8 dB above what above the normal peaks of the track. I want to catch that with a limiter just so the final limiter isn't hit
right
really too hard on those transients.
Is that like one of the tricks on how to get your tracks loud and punchy, and if you have those transients sort of to you know, I mean, yeah, it sounds weird to have the transients and then limit them.
But I'm limiting them. It's not that I'm limiting all the transients. It's limiting transients above a certain level. This song isn't really showing it that much, but remember what we were listening to yesterday, mm-hmm. where there was three or four drums that they all made up one part, and when several of the snares hit at once, it was maybe 10 dB hotter than just
right.
the peaks through the whole song. And that's sort of, you know, I just didn't want it to hit the final limiter that hard and just leave a hole in the whole mix when it limited.
It's a good idea. And in your studio, to judge the low end, you're mixing with your speakers with the Gazowski Swist.
Yeah, which we have
speakers.
Here.
And do you have additional subwoofers?
Yeah, I have a subwoofer. The subwoofer, pretty much almost all the time, it can turn it off and you wouldn't hear the difference, or solo it and you barely hear anything because it's coming in 12 dB per octave below 40 hertz.
Okay.
These speakers are pretty good down to 30, you know, 32 around there. And the subwoofer I'm just using to help the lowest octave.
Okay.
I love low
bottom
end.
Low frequency content.
Yeah. I'm not talking about hip-hop car bass. I'm talking about stuff like right at the limit of audibility.
Yeah.
I just feel I like
more
that.
More like the volcano earthquake type.
Yeah. So I like that. I like to have at least monitored. I don't always use... most music doesn't have that in it, and I usually don't try to generate that much of it with a subharmonic. But mm-hmm.
But you're using subharmonic stuff to generate more low end, right?
Yeah.
What kind of plugins are you using on that?
I use the Avid Pro Subharmonic mm-hmm. mostly, and then there's a plugin called Sasquatch made by Boz Digital Labs, and it's pretty much a synthesizer plugin that's triggered by whatever drum. You can generate a tone. You can make the tone bend over time. You can add attack. It has a little generator that adds a little high frequency burst as an attack.
Okay.
And you mix it with the signal. So if you have, it's useful if you have a kick that's too much damped, or a snare that's just too high and you want it to punch a little more in the low mids. You can generate a tone. You can adjust the envelope of the tone, and you can mix it in there that sounds pretty natural. It just fattens the drum up.
Okay. What about there is another plugin here, the Transgressor?
Transgressor is a transient modifier plugin by Boz Digital Labs. And the nice thing about this one is that you have separate EQ for the decay of the signal and for the transient.
Okay.
So which is really nice because you can brighten the transient of a snare, not only just bring the level up, but you can bring the level up in the high frequencies. I'm going to have to turn this up. So you see here, I'm bringing it up like a little over 3 dB above 5K. Now we can make the transient brighter.
So just the transient, the attack gets a little more EQ.
Or make the transient darker.
That's interesting.
Yeah. And so you can listen to just what it's doing to the transient. You have hold and release controls over the transient, how long it allows the transient to go. I don't want to change too much here because it'll change our mix. But so you can listen to just the transient,
or the release,
or just the release.
Okay.